My name is Jay. I'm the office manager here at Standpoint. So my role today is going to be to help facilitate this webinar. So if you have any questions during the presentation, please type your question into either the Q&A tab or the chat box, and I can help pass this question along to the presenters today. Most of you probably know about our organization already, but for those folks who join on YouTube later or aren't just familiar, Standpoint is a statewide organization. We're a team of attorneys and advocates working to assist individuals who have experienced domestic violence, sexual violence, and trafficking when it includes domestic or sexual violence. We also provide assistance to systems professionals who work with survivors. Standpoint facilitates trainings such as our annual new laws, monthly webinars for advocates such as this one, and other trainings by request. We answer calls on our action line from Monday through Friday from 9 a.m. to 4 p.m. And it's through our action line that our attorneys provide legal advice to survivors, and our advocates connect callers with resources, safety plan, and listen and help callers identify possible options and next steps. This year, we're celebrating our 25th year, and we're raising money this month during Sexual Assault Awareness Month. So you can check out our Facebook page to see how you can help. We're encouraging folks to donate $25 for 25 years of Standpoint. This webinar is being recorded today, and you can check it out on our YouTube page later. The link for the recording will also be emailed out to our Standpoint's legal advocates listserv following the webinar. For today's presentation, I'm going to put this in the chat box right now. You can find a link to the Dropbox, which is going to include PowerPoint and materials. And our presenters today are Amy and Nikki. Just a little brief introduction about Amy. Amy Eisenor joined the team at Standpoint in April of 2018. Amy comes to us with experience in child protection, civil commitments and guardianships, family law, including orders for protection, disillusion and custody, harassment restraining orders, and representing victims of domestic and sexual violence. Having worked as a prosecuting attorney and in representing respondents in civil matters, Amy's nearly 20 years of legal experience and more than that in the social justice field have prepared her to advise attorneys, advocates, and victims with their legal needs. She has received numerous awards for her service to victim survivors. And then we also have Nikki Kelly presenting with us today. And Nikki has worked in the sexual and domestic violence advocacy field since 2012. She has experience providing crisis intervention, safety planning, medical and legal advocacy, and other supportive services to victim survivors from a variety of demographic populations. For example, rural, suburban, youth, college, deaf and hard of hearing, Hispanic, and incarcerated victim survivors. Nikki also has experience coordinating multidisciplinary teams, developing programs, and training advocates. Prior to advocacy work, Nikki served in the United States Air Force. She graduated from Augustine University, majoring in psychology, and holds a Master of Science degree in forensic psychology with specializations in victimology, family violence, and sex offender behavior and treatment from Walden University. Nikki is a member of both the Salute and Sci Chi Honor Societies. So with that, now I'm gonna be sharing the link in the chat box with y'all with the materials, and I'm gonna pass it back off to Amy and Nikki.
Thank you all for joining us. I'm super excited to be here with Nikki today. Nikki has tons of experience and is gonna talk a lot about the history of the movement and victim rights that we'll go through the 611 statute together. Which talks about all of the victim rights in criminal court. There are other victim rights, which we'll talk about as well. And after that, we'll talk about restitution and reparations. We have a jam-packed webinar for you today. Our PowerPoint has tons of information. And in the Dropbox, we've included a lot of other documentation, which we'll be referring to throughout the webinar today that you can refer to on your own or later as well. Some of them are great resources just to print and have right at your desk as you're working. We believe we may not complete the entire webinar today. We're going to see what happens, and we are fully prepared and willing to do part two if we get to that point and we're not able to. We wanna do our best to provide the best webinar and information to you all today. And if that means going a little slower and taking our time going through it, that's what we're gonna do. We also recognize that having an interactive presentation can be helpful to a lot of folks. If you have questions as we're going, do please either type them in the chat box or the Q&A raise your hand or simply unmute yourself and pop in and ask a question. I will note that we will have an opportunity for questions at the end, but if you ask them as we're going through, it may help you as well as others right as we're on that topic to get your brain wrapped around it. I will note that because I am sharing my screen, I will not be able to see y'all or if you raise your hand, so Jay and Nikki will be helping with that today. And I'm gonna let Nikki say what she wants to introduce herself, and then here we go.
Hello, everyone. I'm so glad that you could join us today. We're gonna start out, like Amy said, with talking about the history of the victims' rights movement. Personally, I don't think we can really understand where we're going if we don't understand where we've been to begin with. So let's take a few moments and touch on some of the highlights of this fascinating movement. We're gonna start out going way back in time, because that's really where victims' rights began, is you have to understand how society evolved and how we got to this point in the first place. So one of the things that I want you to consider is that patriarchy, like race, is a social construct. We're gonna play a quick audio clip that really explains this, and then I'll get into this slide a little bit more. So Amy, if you wouldn't mind playing that audio, please.
Survived for so long.
So let's get into it. And let's start by going back a little before the Me Too movement caught fire. Well, thousands of years before. John, you've been the reporter on this project as well as co-host. You spoke with a few scholars who've worked in this area for decades. Tell us what you learned, and then I'll see you in a little bit.
All right. Meet Meg Conkey.
Sure, yeah.
She spent almost half a century doing archaeology, much of it in the French Pyrenees. Yes, looking at those ancient cave paintings, but also digging up stuff out in the open, not in caves.
I didn't like this concept of the caveman. It sort of rubbed me the wrong way in terms of as if our past was all these men dragging women around by the hair. And I also realized archaeologically, a lot of the time they actually didn't live in caves. So the whole idea of a caveman, and then of course its extension, the sort of inner caveman that some men feel they need to express, sort of bothered me. And I said, okay, I've got to go back to some of the basics and let's just see.
Conkey's a professor emerita of anthropology at California Berkeley. Her publications include a book called Engendering Archaeology. She's a leader in applying a feminist critique to the study of prehistory, or what she prefers to call deep time.
My research is about the people who lived during the Ice Age, that is around 15, 20,000 years ago.
Think about the words we use to talk about deep human history. The Stone Age.
Bronze Age, the Iron Age. So
Conkey says this way of carving up time started a few hundred years ago with the people who first did what would eventually be called archaeology.
It was decided that there might have been several different quote-unquote ages of man. Of course, they were the ages of man, and they were all technologically based. So we have the Paleolithic, which is paleo meaning really old and lithic referring to stone.
Then we Conkey notes that archaeology got going at a time of industrial and technological advances. So it's not too surprising that those early researchers thought in those terms when looking at the past. Besides, tools of stone and metal are tangible. You can dig them up and hold them in your hands.
They actually can measure them and organize them into little categories. So I can see why it happens, but it also is clearly, as we know from any classification system, it tells you as much about the organizers as it does about the people that you're trying to organize.
So take a moment and think about that. For me, when I first heard this, it was kind of an aha moment, the idea that idea of an inner caveman or primal instincts, stuff that we have potentially grown up with, could actually just be a creation of people that designed it and their reflection of their beliefs at the time, and not necessarily true. For me, this was my moment where I realized, oh, the earth is actually round. And patriarchy could potentially be a social construct.
If you're 6 feet away from each other, does that mean that no one has actually fallen off the edge of the earth if it's round?
So these aha moments, we want to kind of think about these and don't be afraid to challenge some of these assumptions that we have. So one of the things to think about is that if we're looking at patriarchy as a social construct, then we can realize that some of those assumptions could be wrong, and that society then developed, and that development was generated mostly by people settling down and obtaining property, and then wanting to ensure that that property was transferred to their progeny, which led to controlling offspring, controlling the legitimacy of that offspring, and the subjugation of women. This is a great podcast. If anybody's interested in listening to it, the link is on this slide. I would encourage it. Amy, if we can go to the next slide. So if you think about society as it developed, think about early legal systems, you know, it fell to the families and the individual to seek restitution and reparations. You had things like the Code of Hammurabi that prescribed an eye for an eye. As time evolved, you had feudal lords that might come in as arbiters. You know, if you reflect to Romeo and Juliet, the Montagues and the Capulets, and you had the prince that eventually intervened, but prior to that intervention, they were going to handle it themselves, and it was a very tragic ending for those two families. The same with the Hatfield and McCoy vendetta, family versus family, to obtain what they deemed justice for their perceived wrongs. Next slide. So then we moved into the Enlightenment era. This is the mid-1700s. So it's also around the time of the Industrial Revolution, the same time that we're developing those concepts about the inner caveman and prehistoric individuals. During the Enlightenment era, there's a philosopher named John Locke who started some arguments and some discussions about government. And I want to point out some of this from his treatise. This is chapter 7 of his second treatise, that he basically argued that citizens have to give up certain rights, such as the right to seek justice on their own, in order to be what he deemed as civil. That was the only way to develop a civil society. So if you focus on just the bold sections that I have here, you'll get the gist of what he's saying, that basically civil society is defined by foregoing certain rights to the government and letting the government decide what constitutes a crime and what the punishment for that crime is. Now, those are some really big ideas right there. You're giving government the idea or the power to decide what constitutes a crime. So let's go to the next slide. So using Locke's arguments, the government of the Industrial Revolution said, we're going to be the injured party. That gives us access to fines and fees. It lets us decide what the crime is. So take a moment and think about who are victims of crimes, typically. I'm going to give everybody a moment. If anybody wants to chat in their thoughts, think about it from a statistical perspective. Who are victims of crime? I'm seeing an answer of women. Yep. Minorities. Yep. Children should be on that list. Who's not on that list is white men, right? They're not typically the majority of crime victims. They are, however, especially in the Industrial Revolution, government. They're the ones that suddenly have the power to decide what is a crime and what's the punishment for the crime. Now think about it, who are the perpetrators of crimes? So you have the people in power that are statistically also the people committing the majority of crimes. Yep, white men in power committing the majority of crimes, in charge of labeling the behaviors that constitute crimes and the punishment for said crimes. And Using Locke's arguments about what defines society as civil and what creates a good society, they assumed the role of the injured party. So they moved it from an individual and their family members that were able to seek restitution and reparation to the government being the aggrieved party, the government being able to collect fines and fees, the government being able to decide what justice is and isn't. This essentially excluded the victims from the criminal justice system and made them at best a witness to their own victimization. So though I have a note on the side of this, consider this in the context of abolition and women's suffrage movements. You know, that what I'm getting at here is that victims are still excluded and that they're excluded by the people that have the power. And keep in mind, marital rape was not criminalized until in Minnesota until 2019. So there's still room for progress.
May Next was, slide.
Oh, sorry.
May was less than 2 years ago. And as we were talking yesterday, I've been doing this work for a long time. Jay shared some of my number of years. I'm not going to because people can add. But it never occurred to me until Nikki and I were talking yesterday that it's called the criminal justice system, which means it's not the victim justice system. All of the laws, the Constitution, the Bill of Rights, everything in there is designed to ensure that our citizens, we want the Bill of Rights, we want to be protected from the government, but the purpose is to ensure that the accused has their rights ensured throughout the entire criminal process. We're going to talk through 611A, which is intended to provide some rights for victims through the criminal justice process. But it never occurred to me that that's why we hear so often from victims who are not feeling justice, because it's not intended to give them justice.
No, you're getting ahead of me a little bit, Amy, but yes, you're right. As I have said to many, many victim survivors, far too many in my opinion, it is a criminal justice system, not a victim justice system, and it's certainly not an equal justice system. So some other key moments to think about in the victims' rights movement, you know, that victims were essentially ignored by systems for almost 200 years. It wasn't until the 1940s. So you're jumping from the middle 1700s to the 1940s is when victimology first emerged. And it emerged in the wake of the Holocaust. There were a lot of social scientists that wanted to understand how that could occur. There were studies about in psychology about obedience, compliance, authority, and the victim perpetrator dynamic, the criminal victim relationship as it's stated here. Unfortunately, that approach was based in the just world hypothesis, that idea that good things happen to good people, bad things happen to bad people. So those early social scientists that were studying victimology were looking at what did the Holocaust victims do to contribute to that victimization. As you can guess, we didn't get a lot of good research data from that approach, and we've had to since question that assumption and develop additional theories. In the 1960s, victims gained an increased focus. You know, it was tied into the civil rights movement, the feminist movement, and you also had kind of the emergence of the victims' rights movement. You had the very first commission that tried to address victimization, that created the very first national victimization survey. I know nobody here is surprised that they found that victimization rates were far higher than what law enforcement estimated, because many people weren't reporting. This goes back to the 1960s. We're still at that point. Next slide. In 1973, we had the United States Supreme Court decision that essentially said a victim is not it's not a party to the case. They're not part of the criminal case. And in specifically what they said is a private citizen lacks judicially cognizable interest in the prosecution or non-prosecution of another. This goes back to what Locke did in locking victims out of the court. Ha ha. If anybody caught my pun there and caught my title, you get a gold star. But that's essentially what happened, is the Supreme Court reiterated that, yeah, a victim isn't a party to the criminal court case. That's why it says state v. bad person. In 1974, looking at what the Supreme Court did, Minnesota passed the Crime Victims Reparations Act. And that was also the first time that federal funding was obtained for the crime victims' rights movement. It was also lost in the 1970s. That was the LEA, L-E-A-A, administered that funding. But eventually it was defunded by Congress. In 1981, President Reagan declared the first National Victims' Rights Week, and there was a task force that was launched on violent crime. Next slide. 1982, we're starting to get some momentum in this victims' rights movement now. President Reagan created a second task force, legislation, recommendations came out to protect victim confidentiality, ensure input at sentencing without fear of repercussions. And the task force made a special note that this is important. The interest of victims in seeing their offenders fairly punished and society protected is what enables them to endure the extreme hardships that cooperation with the criminal justice system imposes. When these ends are not accomplished, the victims are justifiably outraged. How many of you think we've reached that point where we've met that goal? In 1983, Minnesota enacted the Crime Victims Bill of Rights as they responded to the task force recommendations and findings. That led to Minnesota Statute 611A, which we're going to dive into. And there were additions that were made in 1986 to increase the ability of victims to participate in the criminal process and lessen their chance for repercussions. So we're going to move into 611A. As Amy said earlier, there are other statutes and rules that provide victims with additional rights. We're going to provide you with an outline, but this is really kind of where you get the nuts and bolts of victims' rights within Minnesota. So we'll start out by talking about the definitions and the scope. You know, a victim can be either an individual, as you see from the top definition from 611A.01, can also be a government entity or any other entity authorized to receive restitution under the associated statutes. I do like the fact that the term victim also includes family members, guardians, conservator, or custodian of a minor, incompetent, incapacitated, or deceased person. So there are secondary victims that are included in this. And it does not include the person charged with or alleged to have committed the crime. They have their own rights. We just talked about this. They have criminal rights. Minnesota Statute 611A.015 talks about the scopes of these rights. It essentially says that it's the statutes 01 to 06. Next slide. All right. So we've tried to organize these a little bit. If you think about it in the context of a criminal court case, we're going to talk about the pretrial rights. So victims have the right to be notified of their rights. They have the right to request that certain public data be withheld. Their address can be kept confidential. They have that right. They also have the right to be notified, particularly domestic assault and criminal sexual conduct, harassment, stalking. Victims have the right to be notified if a prosecutor has decided not to prosecute. I've sat in on meetings, you know, being notified of those declination decisions can be challenging, and victims have the right to meet with a prosecutor to discuss that decision. So you can, as an advocate, if the victim feels that it would be helpful to hear the prosecutor's rationale, you can help arrange a meeting and attend that with them and help them understand where the prosecutor is coming from. One of the things that I have found helpful as an advocate is reminding victim survivors that a no now does not mean a no in the future. If new evidence were to come forward, if something changes, it can always be reviewed again. The door is not shut forever. Victims also have a right to give input regarding pretrial diversion if that exists in your area. Not all areas have that, but they have a right to give input. Giving input does not mean that the wishes are going to be complied with. You'll see that throughout 611A, that you know, a victim can provide their thoughts, but that doesn't mean that the state or the court is obligated to comply with their thoughts. There's also a prohibition against employer retaliation. So one of the important things to note is that employers must allow reasonable time off so that a victim can attend criminal proceedings. And that's where reparations and restitution can be helpful, because that time off doesn't necessarily have to be paid. So those lost wages can be recouped through those programs that we're going to talk about later. Victims also have the right to have a separate waiting area in the courthouse. They don't have to be in the same room with their assailant. They don't have to necessarily see that person. And I'm pretty sure we wouldn't want them. I mean, you can imagine some of the brawls that could happen in the middle of the courthouse hallways. You know, we really don't need the Montagues and Capulets all over again, or the Hatfields and McCoys. Did we skip? Here's trial rights. No, pretrial sentencing. Okay. Yeah, trial rights. There aren't many. Other than you have to comply with the subpoena if you're given one, or face the consequences of not. You have the right to attend the trial is the other piece that victims have. There are sentencing rights, however. So if we've reached a conviction, we're at the sentencing phase for the defendant, then victims have the right to give a victim impact statement as part of the pre-sentence investigation. That can be confidential. So that's something you might consider discussing with your clients. That some advocates, you can give a victim impact statement with the advocate and submit it to the court. That becomes public if you go through community corrections, probation office, and they're doing the pre-sentence investigation. That victim impact statement can be confidential. And the only individuals that get to see it are the judge and the attorneys. If the defendant is pro se, they would get to see it in that case. But if they're represented, their attorney can see it and then can go back and tell the defendant a summary, but can't actually disclose to the defendant what's in that confidential victim impact statement. They're also entitled to know the location and time of the hearing, and they have a right to be present for the sentencing hearing. They have a right to present a victim impact statement. Community impact statements can also be done. I think we've seen some really powerful victim impact statements recently. If you think about like the Larry Nassar case, those brought me to tears. I don't know about the rest of you. We also have the right to be notified if they're being released from incarceration. So you can sign up on VineLink and other sources like that to get those notices. You can contact the point of incarceration on behalf of your clients. Let those places know that the victim survivor wants that notice. They also have a right to notice of the final disposition or if the sentence is going to be modified. So if there's a plea agreement or something is going to change, they have a right to know about that. So they have the right to know the date and time of the review, location, telephone number or contact for additional information. And then they can also provide a statement. Following sentencing, hopefully incarceration. Victim survivors do have the right to be notified if the perpetrator is going to appeal it. They have a right to know how that process works and what the state's position will be and the result of it. Arguably, they have a right to give input to the state as well. So if the state is deciding not to object to the appeal, they can let the state know how they feel about that. Again, it may not change the state's position, but they have the right to give that input. They have a right to be notified about release from incarceration and a right to be notified if the individual is seeking expungement, escapes, and they have a right to have knowledge of the defendant's location, but that's limited knowledge. Again, the defendant has rights. It's a criminal justice system, not a victim justice system.
That right to know where they are is only in qualified domestic violence related offenses. Yeah. There are other ones also, but this particular 611A was designed for domestic violence cases.
Yeah. And it is limited. I mean, you might know the city or a zip code location, but you're not going to have much more information than that, which may or may not provide victim survivors with peace of mind. Some of the other highlights of 611A, victim survivors have the right to request that the defendant be tested for HIV and other diseases in CSC cases. They have the right to their sexual assault evidence information as well. And then we're going to show you a document that lists a bunch of the other rights that we just don't have time to go through today.
So this document I did drop into the Dropbox, so you have it. It's also on OJP's website. It goes through, this is the one I print and have on my desk at all times when I'm talking to victims. It goes through the statutes, as it's kind of small on here, but so 611A, 244, next to each part of the right they have, it gives the description and the statute number. So you can use this to go back to law enforcement with them. It talks about their rights through the crime process. So there's a section of several pages of their rights from the court, what the judges and the court administration have to make sure that victims have access to. There's a section that goes through the prosecutor, what rights they have from anywhere from the time where law enforcement refers the case over to prosecution until after appeal. Law enforcement, from the time of their first report all the way through release, to be notified of when the person and where they are, if they're let go. Probation, to get their input and to make sure that their position is heard and held throughout the case. Probation is going to be like the pre-sentencing investigation and then the supervision. Custodial facilities is going to be jails and prisons, potentially hospitals if the person is found incompetent by reason of mental illness. Is there a question, Nikki?
There is. I'll read it in a moment.
Okay.
Yeah, we also have a raised hand question too that we'll get to when you're set.
I'll just finish this document quick and then we can do that. So it goes through custodial facilities and then others, the Board of Pardons, hospitals, safe at home, Department of Human Services, landlords, employers. What rights do you have as a victim in lots of different areas? So like I said, this is super handy to have. I always have it in my little folder when I'm taking calls so that I can easily access the rights and tell them what they can or can't do. Mm-hmm. We'll talk about it in a minute after we answer some questions about enforcement, but let's get to the questions first.
Yeah, so one of the questions that I see is, what is the victim's rights to request from probation officers the suspect's or respondent's address when they're filing for an OFP, and they need the address to serve him with the OFP? As far as I know, it's not covered in the statute. It's not guaranteed that a probation officer has to disclose that. And in fact, most probation officers won't. They'll cite confidentiality. So you really can't request that. Well, I take that back. You can request it, but it doesn't mean it's going to be given to you.
I would think you might have a better chance with DMV or law enforcement looking up a license plate or something.
Yeah. I mean, a lot of times with OFPs, what I've done is just put down the probation officer's information on like the law enforcement information sheet. If you can get it through the court that you don't have that person's address, or put the most recent address that is known, and then put the probation officer, that's the role of law enforcement when they're trying to serve that ex parte or that initial order. If they can't find it, you're going to get that certificate of non-service, and then you would do the service by publication at that point. Melissa, does that answer your question?
All right, I'll give Melissa a second to share in the chat if that's correct. Looks like it did. And looks like we have a question from Julia. Julia, I'm going to give you the opportunity to unmute.
Julia, you're still muted. We can't hear you. Jay, are you able to unmute Julia?
I'm not. For now, Julia, if you can hear me, I'm going to just lower your hand for now. But if you still have your question, please raise your hand again and we'll get back to you later.
Sounds good.
It does look like we have another raised hand. So, Vicky, I will let you talk.
Oh, I'm seeing they don't have access to unmute themselves, Jay.
I'm also having trouble getting to the next slide, so I'm going to stop sharing my screen and share it again. Give me just a second.
Okay, I'm going to figure out why I can't. It doesn't give me the option to unmute. So I'm going to see what might be going on. So sorry, folks.
All right, so some quick things to note. Melissa has a follow-up question. Amy, I wanna take care of this slide and then we'll answer her follow-up question because this slide is really easy. And one of the biggest struggles with victims' rights, one of the biggest things that the victims' rights movement is still trying to resolve is that these rights lack enforceability. You know, if the statute says things like the prosecutor shall take input, but what happens if they don't? What happens if they come to a plea agreement and don't consult the victim in the case? Honestly, nothing really. I mean, maybe a judge says, you naughty prosecutor, don't do that again, but the case keeps going forward. One of the other things to note is there has been some chatter about a constitutional amendment that would create a victim's rights in the Constitution. So a victim's Bill of Rights, you would have the Bill of Rights that we normally have and then one for victims. That's something, if you feel strongly about it, I would encourage you to reach out to your congressional representatives. And Melissa's question, follow up about service of an OFP, can the probation officer help serve the suspect with a copy of it? Yes, no, why not? If no.
If they are considered law enforcement, yes. If you get permission from the court to serve by alternative means, including either through probation or mail, yes. I don't know if they can serve the original one. Do you, Nikki?
I'm sorry, say that again.
I don't know if they can just serve it without a SAMS. You.
They can't because of the documentation that the court requires that service of, or that certificate of service has to be signed by a law enforcement officer unless you have alternative permission from the court.
That's what I thought. I've never tried it, so I have never looked at it. I don't know, but that's what I thought. Any other questions before we move on here? Oh, we did this one already.
Mm-hmm. Yep, you went backwards. Fun. That's why we did a history first, is so that we wouldn't have to go backwards.
We're doing it anyway. Do it, Nikki. Do it, do it, do it.
Show me the money!
I really wanted to name the whole presentation that, but we thought it might make other people think think that victims are greedy or stingy or somehow are reporting for money, which they absolutely are not. And we all know that. So we didn't title it that for YouTube.
But no, we went with the punny title.
The punny title. So we're going to talk about money and ways that victims can be financially compensated for their losses.
You really like this additional rights. You really want to emphasize it.
They're very important.
It is a great link. I will give you that. That OJP resource is well worth having.
Sorry, guys. I don't know why my computer is mad at me. Okay, restitution is described in chapter 611A.04 through 0.05. There's a couple other ones in between, even though there's no numbers in between, like 0.045 and 0.048. So if you ever want to go back and look at it, that's where you can find it, but we'll talk through it quick. So if I've been a victim of a crime, the perpetrator has been charged and is being sentenced. That's when I'm given the opportunity to talk about my financial loss and my request for restitution. So when a crime is charged, typically the county attorney's office, through their victim witness person or the other prosecutor's office, city and other municipality prosecutors, through their paralegal or staff, will send to the victim a packet of information notifying them that a charge is being brought of their rights. It might have a copy of a victim impact statement. It might have a copy of a restitution packet, which they can fill out. Typically, in a bunch of information they get right at the beginning, it's overwhelming. They don't look through it. They toss it aside somewhere because why am I getting all this paperwork? And so I did include in here, in the Dropbox, from the court's website, the instructions for the crime victim's restitution packet, which here's a copy of it, and then the actual affidavit for restitution, which is just this one-page document that says this is the things that were damaged, broken, stolen, whatever, or my out-of-pocket loss, which we'll talk about the things that you can apply for. But this is the simple one-page affidavit, and then additional verification can be attached to that, receipts or insurance information. I'm seeing bleeping at the bottom of my screen, but I can't read the questions. So I'm going to get through this slide, and then you want to go ahead and let me know, Nikki?
Actually, you're doing just fine. It's just some messages from admin. You're okay.
Okay. So the pre-sentence investigation is an investigation done by the probation officer after a guilty plea or a guilty verdict has been made, found.
Entered?
Okay. A guilty plea has been entered or a verdict of guilty has been found. There you go. And restitution is paid as part of the sentence by the defendant to the victim. It's paid through court administration, but it's part of their actual sentence. So as part of the pre-sentence, they have to be convicted of the crime, or if it's a juvenile, have to be adjudicated for the crime. There are a lot of plea agreements that a person will plead guilty and they will not be convicted or adjudicated. Mm-hmm. In those cases, restitution cannot be sought unless it's specifically included as part of the plea agreement. So that is something that prosecutors honestly often will forget. And if a victim wants restitution, they should file early and let the prosecutor know of their loss so that the affidavit is filed with the court and the court's aware of it before accepting a guilty plea. It shouldn't be the onus on the victims, but I think in those kind of circumstances it would be, because the statute says convicted or adjudicated, which people don't always think about. So
I'm going to jump in. I have found it helpful because you can include maybe expenses to go to court, like lost wages that we talked about earlier. Just letting the victim witness coordinator in the prosecutor's office know that you might potentially have expenses and that you want to keep restitution option available. usually is enough that you shouldn't have to file the affidavit of restitution early in the case. Some prosecutors do it a little bit differently, but oftentimes I've found that that's effective.
You can always file an amended one too, or continue adding your to it, but sometimes having the affidavit in there is in the file then and filed with the court, so the judge knows and it won't get lost as easily. So in that pre-sentence investigation, the probation officer is supposed to contact the victim, ask them if they have any of these losses, and include their affidavit for restitution as part of that report and as part of the victim's impact. When they're looking at the impact on society and public safety, that's something that they're considering when writing their pre-sentence investigation. So that includes a summary of the damages or harm, any other problems generated from the crime itself, directly from the crime, a statement of what sentence the victim deems appropriate. So this is a different victim impact right while the PSI is occurring to tell the probation officer what they think should happen, what consequences there should be. And then, of course, they include their out-of-pocket loss for restitution purposes. So a crime victim has the right to receive restitution as part of the sentence. They have to request the amount based on their out-of-pocket loss occurring due to the crime. They have to provide evidence for it. If there is a contested hearing, they're going to have to be able to provide documentation of what their actual out-of-pocket losses include. So this slide just talks about some of the ways that you can do that through an itemized list, total dollar amounts claimed, why it's justified. A victim does have an obligation to mitigate their loss. So if you can claim insurance, you have to claim insurance. Then you might ask for the defendant to pay the copay. You can ask for your property to be returned. You can ask for a new item of the property, or you can ask for cash restitution. So it can include out-of-pocket losses, which also can include medical and therapy costs, replacement of wages and services, either for coming to court, for participating in meetings with the prosecutor because you're preparing for trial, or having to be gone to go to medical appointments, or for simply being injured to the point where you're unable to work. Expenses incurred to return a child. This is for one specific crime. If we have a deprivation of parental rights and somebody's taken the child out of state, we have to travel to get the child. Specifically, you can ask for expenses for that. And then funeral expenses if the victim has passed away. Just because a victim also has a right to file a civil suit and to sue the perpetrator for the offense, the court cannot say, go sue them and go get your compensation that way. I'm not giving you restitution. Or they can't say, I heard that you did file a civil suit, so I'm not going to give you anything. It is cannot be denied based on that basis. It must have happened because it was specifically added to the statute. Mm-hmm. People who also can receive restitution on behalf of a victim are the victim's family, or if the victim has died due to the crime, payment to assist, the payment of restitution would go to a victim fund. So if they've already been fully compensated through another form, insurance paid for the medical bills or whatever happened, if the victim is deceased or already fully compensated, any payment of money goes to the victim assistance program, which goes to reparations, which we'll talk about in a little bit when we're done with restitution. So the procedure that the court goes through when determining whether they will grant restitution to the victim is that at the sentencing hearing, the court gives the offender an opportunity to respond to the affidavit that the victim has filed. Victim files the affidavit, files their attached documents, receipts, itemized list, whatever, gives it to the prosecutor. Prosecutor files it into the court, and as part of the sentencing recommendation says, we're asking for restitution to be ordered in this amount to this victim. The offender then at that hearing, at their sentencing hearing, is given an opportunity to object to that, to the specific dollar amount, to the items. I didn't steal that. I didn't burn that part. I didn't break that. Or, yeah, I broke it, but it was worth $5, not $5,000. And the court then will decide at that hearing if they're going to consider the arguments that they make at that point. They also have an opportunity later after to file within 20 days of restitution being ordered to file an objection, and then a full restitution hearing would be held, which is a different matter. That doesn't take place at the sentencing hearing. When determining restitution, the court needs to consider both the amount of loss sustained by the victim as a result of the offense, but also the ability of the defendant to pay it. What other obligations do they have? Are they going to prison where they're going to make 25 cents an hour? Or are they out in the community at their regular job and they need to pay monthly payments of whatever? Do they have 8 kids that they have to provide child support, and paying this restitution is going to harm the children? The judge may deny restitution based on the defender's need. Nikki, did you have your hand up?
Yeah, I was going to point out one of the things that I see and imagine is contested quite a bit is when it comes to maybe mental health expenses. If the victim survivor seeks counseling of any kind, that is something that can be often contested, that I didn't cause it, they had this pre-existing condition. And what that leads to is a requirement that the victim survivor may have to submit their counseling records. So there's some privacy and confidentiality concerns that can come up with that particular request for restitution.
We also,
I'd be very, very cautious about asking for any of that in restitution, because that's available through reparations and the defendant has no access to that information.
Right.
That's something I would probably not ask for at a contested hearing.
Well, and that segues pretty well into the question that we've got, that somebody was asking about, doesn't restitution take a long time and reparations is quicker? They're wondering if it's a case-by-case basis. We're going to talk a little bit more about reparations, but restitution takes the duration of the case, whatever, however long that is, or however short that is. Reparations, I've submitted applications and had them approved and a case opened within a matter of a couple weeks. I think their website says it can take 30 to 60 days for it to go through that approval process. So it's kind of dependent upon your perspective of what quick is.
It also is a case by case for both, because it depends on what verification and evidence you have for it. It depends on the defendant in a restitution case. If you have a wealthy defendant, maybe they just pay you cash the first day and it's done. Or they have through the duration of their probationary period to pay it. So if they're on probation for 30 years, they might take 30 years to pay it. I would argue, as we're going to go through restitution the slides in a little bit, that's not going to happen. But it does require the victim to push it forward. So we'll go to the next slide here.
Yeah, I think that's something to emphasize now, and we're going to emphasize it throughout, that restitution is the offender has to pay it. And if you think of that in the context of maybe child support or other forms of payment that people are ordered to pay, it gets tricky.
So if they want to dispute it, the defendant has the burden to challenge the amount. He files a petition and affidavit setting forth the challenges, specifying the reasons why the dollar amounts are disputed. For example, I stole your car and totaled it. You're claiming your car was worth this much money. I saw Kelly Blue Book saying it's worth this much money. I also saw it at the impound lot for this much money. I'm not going to pay you the full amount. So they dispute the proper amount or type of restitution, which is then resolved through a hearing, which is like a little mini trial, an evidentiary hearing. Once they've made the burden of challenging it, it's then the burden of the prosecutor to prove the dollar amount that the victim is requesting and the appropriateness of why that particular restitution is appropriate for this crime. why these out-of-pocket losses are directly attenuated to the crime that has been convicted of. Sometimes you will see, and we've talked about it in new laws in the last couple of years, I broke into a house, I robbed a bunch of things, nobody was there. My buddies were with me. They lit the trailer on fire outside. The whole trailer burnt down. I got convicted of burglary. I was not convicted of arson because I wasn't out there by the trailer. I have to pay restitution only for what I'm convicted of, which is the burglary. I'm not paying for that trailer or all the things you had inside of it. I'm paying for the vase I broke or took or whatever from the robbery. I don't know why suddenly I think vases are so valuable and like TVs and computers are not the real things being stolen. I don't know what my deal is today. Vases, that's what I'm all about.
Apparently someone needs to get you flowers.
Yeah, hey, maybe that's my deal. So an order for restitution has to be specific. I'm granting it, denying it, or I'm partially granting it. And the court needs to specify why. They have to make findings about how this is attenuated to the crime, why this is the appropriate dollar amount, what evidence I based it on. If they only award partial restitution, for example, I'm the victim of the burglary and arson, I file this amount of restitution, the court only grants me the burglary portion. The court has to specify how much of the judgment can be docketed as a civil judgment, which is then that rest of that arson part is going to be off. If the victim wants to enter it as a civil judgment, this is the dollar amount that can be docketed. The court may not require that the victim waive any rights or causes of action as a condition of getting restitution. They can't say, if I give you restitution, I will give you restitution, but you have to sign and waive your right to sue this person. Or you can't then go through the other defendant and seek restitution or whatever, any kind of waiver of right that the victim has. The court cannot require that. In the case of a defendant who's on probation, if they fail to pay, like Nikki was talking about, the fathers who child support issues of the non-custodial parent, those issues we have, the victim can ask probation to violate the defendant for not following their terms and conditions of probation. Payment plan will be set up through court administration or probation. And like every month you pay this much on this date. If you don't file it, that is a probation violation. So the perpetrator pays to court administration collects it, then disperses to the victim. Victim can ask probation to violate them if probation's not doing it on their own. Again, at this level, if the defendant's already on probation, and still not paying restitution, the court can't say, no, I'm not gonna make him pay because you also sued him. You have a right to go parallel parts here.
I will point out, like you were saying, Amy, the victim has a right to request that probation implement a payment plan, that probation submit a violation report for failure to pay restitution. You're shaking your head. Did I hear that incorrectly?
You can request the violation. There has to be a payment plan statutorily required by probation or court administration.
Okay.
Typically, in my experience, it's through court administration.
But even still, that request for a violation is just that, it's a request. Doesn't mean a probation officer is going to do it.
You can also file your own into the criminal case mm-hmm. saying that they're failing to pay. But yeah, you can't make anybody do anything. If the sentencing or dispositional hearing has already been completed and we're done, but the victim then has more expenses, or they didn't know the expenses at the time of sentencing, as long as the court continues to have jurisdiction over the defendant, they're either in prison, jail, probation, supervised release, as long as there's jurisdiction over that person, and there's sufficient evidence to demonstrate that more restitution is appropriate or that we now have the number that we didn't have before, the court can enter restitution post-sentencing as well. So in order to enforce it, just like Nikki said, you can request lots of things. We can't make anybody do anything. but it is a right with no teeth and no enforcement, just like all victim rights have no enforcement. An order of restitution may be enforced by any person named in the order to receive it. So I don't know why that's important. I guess if a husband and wife lose property, they get divorced, the husband's the only person on the restitution order. Wife can't go later try to claim that restitution because they're not named in the order. The restitution goes directly to the victim, not to a marital claim. You do not have to pay filing fees if you want to docket the restitution order as a civil judgment. Oftentimes, if the restitution payments aren't being made, if it's a large amount, it might be worth it for the victim to enter it as a civil judgment so that it can be recouped through other means, just like child support payments are, taxes, through paychecks, other ways that it can be received. The defendant may not discharge a restitution obligation through bankruptcy, so they maintain that obligation. Again, receiving restitution doesn't bar a victim from a civil action. And when a person is ordered to enter a fine, fees, surcharges, library fee, all the things that they're ordered to pay when they are sentenced, and restitution, court administration collects all of these things into different pockets and different accounts. They're required to use that money to pay restitution first to ensure the victim is made whole before all these other fines and fees are collected. I don't know if that really happens, but that's what the statute says. I think sometimes other things get paid. If they haven't collected money, they've notified the victim that they have money, they've tried to send the money to the victim, victim moved. If within 3 years the victim has not collected it, it is put into the crime victim's account, which then goes to reparations, which we'll talk about in a little bit. And then post-sentencing rights. If you've been through the sentence given restitution and it's not being paid, here's the victim has the right to ask probation to request a probation review hearing or violation hearing if the offender has failed to pay restitution as required. And then expungement. If a person, we're all done, the case is discharged, the person's off probation, it's been 10 years, they go back to the court, file a petition asking for expungement of their criminal record. One of the things that the court is required to consider is whether there was any outstanding restitution left at the time the matter was discharged, and what efforts the defendants made to try to make the payment, any measures to help ensure that the completion of the restitution payment after expungement of the record will occur. I'm thinking that there's probably zero measures to ensure that that's going to get paid if we're 10 years later and you're asking for expungement. It's something the court has to consider if there's outstanding restitution payment.
Yeah, I think the only recourse at that point is that civil option.
Yep. Entering as a civil judgment, which hopefully you did way before 10 years.
Right.
maybe like after 6 months or so if you haven't been paid. The Crime Victim Reparations Board is who controls reparations, which we're going to be talking about in a little bit if we have time. But they can also request restitution. They can file an affidavit either on behalf of the victim or on behalf of themselves saying, we paid the victim reparation. Now you, defendant, need to pay us back because we have this out-of-pocket expense due to your crime. And so the court can order that they reimburse the Crime Victims Reparations Board, or that they pay directly to the victim, or that they pay the Crime Victims Reparations Board so the Crime Victim Reparations Board can pay the victim. We already talked about that part. So we are done with history, general rights, and restitution. Again, I will note, restitution is paid by the defendant to the victim. Reparations is a whole different thing where the defendant is not involved. And we'll talk about that process and how it works and how as advocates we can help our victims get that resource. are there any outstanding questions up until reparations?
I don't see any at the moment.
We go till 3:30, is that correct?
We do.
Okay. So I'm going to go ahead and start reparations. We will do our best to get through it. We have 25 minutes. If you have questions, please keep them coming. I want to make sure that you understand this process and how you can best serve victims as we go through it. It is complicated, and Nikki has had successful experiences working with reparations. I have had unsuccessful experiences working with reparations. So I have come in after the victim has been denied. So I'm already coming from like the back end. Nikki has had success when she's helped the victims to prepare their request and submit their evidence. And therefore, I think that shows that having a strong advocate supporting the victim at the beginning to get going through this is super important, because when I come in at the back end after it's been denied, it's much more difficult for me to be able to do anything to fix it. So the statutes for reparations are 611A.51 through 611A.71. There's a bunch of things in there. I tried to compile it and make it into something that makes sense, but if you want to read it, that's where you can find it. So who's eligible and what requirements are there to get reparations? Reparations money is collected by the Crime Victim Reparations Board by all those other fees and surcharges and fines that victims, that defendants are required to pay when they're convicted. So you hear the victim, they have a $500 fee, $75 service charge, $75 law library charge, and $20,000 fine, which never gets ordered. It's usually like you're ordered to pay it and it's stayed if you pay the $2,000 or something. That $2,000 fine from every offense, whether there's a victim or not, goes to the crime victim reparations pot of money. So every defendant pays money, a fine, towards this pot. This pot is then used for victims who need reparations. There's lots of crimes that don't have a victim or don't have restitution or don't have a person who needs financial compensation, but we still collect money from those folks to help victims of other crimes. So that's where the money comes from. So who's eligible? Who can ask for it? A victim for reparations purposes is defined as a person who suffers personal injury or death as a direct result of the crime, an effort to prevent the crime, or an effort to apprehend the person suspected of engaging in a crime. So I'm 21. My mom and her boyfriend are in a fight. I step in to protect my mom. He breaks my jaw. I now have injuries. I'm not the victim of the crime. The crime was the domestic abuse on my mom, although I might have a crime too of an assault. Mm-hmm. So that was a bad example. But if I get injured doing any of these things, we'll talk about it in a minute, but I do want to point out injury, thank God, has been modified to include pregnancy. If you become pregnant as a result of a crime, that is considered an injury and you can ask for reparations. And emotional harm has also now been added and included as an injury for which you can ask for reparations. So if you suffer personal injury or death from any of these three persons, you qualify as a victim. A defendant is dependent, not the same as a defendant.
No.
Totally different person. They are actually, it's very important to note, because the defendant specifically cannot ask for reparations. If you have been committing a crime and you get hurt, even by the other person, you can't ask for reparations.
Right, because they don't have victims' rights. Reparations is a victim's rights. That's how you get there.
But it's specifically in the statute, so I'm pointing it out. So a dependent of the victim is a person who is dependent financially on the deceased victim for support at the time of the crime. So it could be their child, it could be their spouse, it could be anyone, it could be an adult child who is in college and receives financial assistance and the parent can continue to claim them on their taxes or whatever they would have done. A person is dependent on the victim. They are entitled to ask for reparations as well. So to be entitled, the victim has incurred an economic loss, or a dependent who has incurred an economic loss, or the estate of the deceased victim that has incurred an economic loss. So a parent is murdered. They had an estate that would have gone to their children as inheritance had they not been murdered and they died normally. Now there's all these medical fees because they were in the hospital for a month and had lots of surgeries trying to save them and lots of other things. They die. The estate has all these bills that they have to pay before the estate can be done. The state has a right to ask for all these bills to be paid by reparations so the estate can be made whole because of the crime. That's the only way that that works for the estate, I believe. For the dependent, there's lots of other ways, and we'll talk about those in a minute. Mm-hmm. So crime is conduct that poses a substantial threat of personal injury or death and is included in the Minnesota Criminal Code, which is our 609 statute. There's also a couple other statutes that are crimes. They're also defined in the first part of 609. So like our DWIs and driving is in a separate section. Our drug crimes are in a separate section, but they're primarily located in 609. A crime occurs whether or not the person was prosecuted or convicted. If the person is convicted of the crime, it gives the victim a conclusive evidence that yes, this crime occurred, this is how I was harmed. That's evidence that dude did it and I should be compensated. However, if they're never prosecuted, if I just go to law enforcement and make a report and I cooperate and nothing happens, I still can go to reparations and ask for financial compensation due to the crime. I have to demonstrate that the crime occurred. They have to believe me. I have to demonstrate that my loss is due to the crime and they have to believe me. But I don't have to have my crime prosecuted and convicted to be able to ask for this. And it cannot have been an accident resulting in injury or death unless it otherwise would have been a crime. So if you have a car accident and somebody dies or is injured and has medical expenses, you can't ask for reparations unless the behavior was a DWI, a DUI, criminal vehicular operation or something like that. If it was just an accident, that doesn't qualify. And there has to be an actual economic detriment incurred as a direct result of the injury or death. You can't say, I think that it probably would have cost me this much to fix it, but I'm not going to fix it. But I want the money anyway. I have to fix it, know what the cost is, and ask for that amount. I can't just ask for random money because I might someday fix it. That gets to be an issue, which we'll talk about in a little bit, about like ongoing therapy and moving forward. When we get to the application, Nikki will talk a little bit about some hints of how to do that. Mm-hmm. I have had a case denied because the client was a criminal sexual conduct victim and didn't have enough money to go to therapy, so she couldn't go to therapy. She was asking for money so she could pay to be able to go to therapy. That's not an out-of-pocket loss. She has not had an economic detriment yet, and they wouldn't provide her with reparations because it was a hopeful expense. If she had receipts of that and then asked for it, I think it would have been successful. That's a tricky thing, and Nikki can talk about that in a little bit. Keep that on your radar, Nikki, because I might.
I will. Yeah, because there is a solution to that problem now.
Great. So if a crime results in injury, here are the things you can ask for. An injury includes actual bodily harm, including pregnancy and emotional trauma. Reasonable expenses actually incurred. So if I spend $1 million and I could have spent $500, they're only going to give me the $500 because that's the reasonable amount. For medical, chiropractic, hospital, rehabilitative, dental, ambulance, or prescription medication, psychological or psychiatric services. So at the beginning of every fiscal year, the Board of Reparations sets limits on the amount of money that will be allowed that year for specific things. One of the things is funerals. Another thing is psychiatric or psychological services. They will put a dollar amount limit for the year for what the victim can receive. Loss of income, for the reasons we talked about, the same as restitution. Substitute childcare or household services to replace those the victim or the claimant would have performed had the victim not been injured. My husband was injured. He was the stay-at-home parent. I've been working out of the house our whole lives. We have a three-year-old. Now I have to either hire daycare for the child or I have to change my career so that I'm able to stay home with the child. I have to change my career so I'm able to stay home to care for my husband because he's disabled. Things like that can be included in loss of income as well as services to replace the what the claimant or victim would have provided. There is a maximum amount of what a victim can take, can get. So we'll get to that too. This isn't forever and ever, but this is for your emergency. Like this happened, now we have to readjust. This year I need help. The same thing as with restitution, money to return a child who was the victim of the parent or lawful custodian being taken from that parent. So transportation costs to go get the child, meals and lodging from the time the child is located until they're returned to their home. And moving expenses if you have to move due to the crime, including storage fees, phone and utility installation, up to $1,000 for the move. If the injury results in death, you have those same kind of things of the loss of childcare or spousal support, household support services that you might have had. You also can ask for reasonable expenses for the funeral costs. Again, that dollar amount is the maximum amount is determined by the board at the beginning of the fiscal year. Reasonable expenses for the care that was required for the victim prior to their death, for which the estate remains liable. Insurance didn't cover it. We still have this amount of bills. Loss of support. They were the only income. I stayed home with the kids and now my husband is dead. I need help so that we can survive. Loss of support for a minor child. They were paying me child support or we lived together and they helped pay for our child. Up to for 3 years, they will pay you. Every 3 years, you can ask again until the child is 18 and they'll reevaluate based on your ongoing need, based on your current income, now the kids in school, now whatever's happening, they'll reevaluate it, but the maximum time you can get it is for up to 3 years. When the child turns 18, that ends. We already talked about those other two. I talk off the slide and then I have to look and see. Did we talk about that? So in order to be eligible, the victim also has to do several things. They have to have reported the crime to law enforcement within 30 days of the crime occurring, if possible. If it's not possible, they can report within 30 days of it becoming possible. New statutes have gone into place to acknowledge that victims who are victims of criminal sexual conduct in the first, second, third, or fourth degree felony level crim sex do not have to report within 30 days. They are deemed to have been, for it to have been impossible if they, for whatever reason, are unable to report. If they do report, then it, obviously that's not an issue, but it allows them extra time to be able to do so. Mm-hmm. That also applies to victims of child abuse. if you report later or a parent reports later that my child's been a victim of child abuse, that does not have to fall within those 30-day timeline. The victim or the victim's parent has to fully cooperate with law enforcement. So even if it doesn't get charged, you've cooperated, you've provided them the evidence they wanted, they've been able to investigate and provide a report to you. I was not committing a crime at the time I was being harmed. And it has to be more than $50. If your request is less than $50, you will be denied. The maximum you can get is $50,000. So between $50,000 and $50,000 to any one victim. So reparations will equal the amount of economic loss, except you have to take reasonable steps to recoup. If you're able to send it to insurance, you have to do that. If you're getting restitution, you have to do that. If you sue them and get money, you have to accept that money. We will help you with what's left because we want you to be made whole. We are not here to fund you. Reparations shall be denied or reduced due to the contributory misconduct of the claimant or victim. If, for example, they're making it worse, they're breaking more, I don't know what that means. If you're doing something bad, you might not get reparations. So don't, please. Thanks. Mm-hmm. So the reparations board is made of 5 members who are appointed by the Commissioner of Public Safety. So John Harrington every year appoints 5 people to this board. One of them is a physician. One of them is a crime victim. And the other 3 can be anybody who applies to be and is accepted and appointed onto this board. So it's just people making decisions. Mm-hmm. The process for determining the claim is that I submit my application, which is in your Dropbox along with the instructions. Nikki will talk about that when we, maybe not because we have 8 minutes left and I'm gonna keep talking fast so we can get through it. Then they investigate it. They say, is this a valid claim? Did a crime occur? Do they have evidence of the crime? Police report. Do they have evidence of the out-of-pocket loss, receipts, claims, whatever they have? They will then make a decision for or against the claimant, granting it or denying their request, and issue a written decision notifying the victim of their decision. If it's denied, the claimant can ask for reconsideration, and then the board will re-examine all of the information again. And the claimant is given an opportunity to provide additional information at that time. The board can also do its own independent investigation, getting information that the victim hasn't provided. You will have to sign tons and tons of releases of information to law enforcement, probation, if the person's on probation, medical records. This is an area why I would recommend that if you're asking for restitution or reparations for mental health services, that you're asking for it here. You're asking for it in reparations rather than restitution, because the defendant isn't going to get access to your medical records, but the reparations board is, and they're confidential. They can't let it go anywhere else, but you sure don't want the defendant knowing about it. So you might want to ask for that in reparations instead. Upon reconsideration, then, after the independent investigation that they do, they either affirm, modify, or reverse their prior decision. And if you're still denied, you can ask for a contested hearing where each person would provide like a little mini trial. Other considerations, you can get reparations either in monthly installments or regular installments or in a lump sum. We also have the emergency award, which we'll talk about because we have 6 minutes left and I'm going to get there, about how we know that advocacy programs can apply 3 a year or something for victims for this program. If a victim is awarded emergency funds, that's deducted from their final award. Reparations are exempt from execution or attachment, which means that if I have a child support obligation that I have to pay and they're garnishing my wages or they're garnishing my taxes or whatever, nobody can come and claim this. My reparations is to make me whole for a crime. It is not my income. It is not money that you can take from me. Medical privilege, that's what we were talking about. primarily regarding the health record, the mental health records. They are not confidential. You will be waiving medical, psychological, psychiatric privilege to allow them to look and make sure that your claim is based on the crime. They're not going to be caring too much about what you're talking about, so I'm not super worried about this waiver. You do have to waive it, though. This does not ever, ever, ever waive attorney-client privilege. I would argue it probably does not waive advocate privilege also. Other considerations. If the victim doesn't comply with requests, we've asked you for more documentation, you can forfeit your right to the claim. We're just not going to get talk to you anymore because you're not doing what we're asking you to do. We don't know and we can't answer you. You cannot be held in contempt or get in trouble for that, however. The Department of Corrections is supposed to provide ways for victims to be compensated, for defendants to be able to earn money and contribute towards restitution for the people they've harmed. Law enforcement agencies are supposed to provide victims with notice of their right to apply for reparations with the telephone number and applications form. I don't know if that's always happening, but that's a victim right that they're supposed to be getting at their contact with law enforcement. And law enforcement agencies are supposed to provide request reports within 10 days. So either me as the victim or reparations board is asking police for my police report. They're supposed to provide it within 10 days so that the victim can be financially compensated and move forward. If you lie and you ask for a false claim, it's a gross misdemeanor. Don't do it. That's bad. Emergency funds. So DPS, again, John Harrington, Department of Public Safety, makes grants to prosecutors and victim assistance programs providing emergency assistance. So that's replacement of necessary property that was lost, damaged, or stolen. If I need to put emergency like security devices, cameras, something into my house to make me and my children safe. Transportation to locations related to the victim's needs, such as medical facilities, criminal justice facilities, therapy, et cetera. Cleanup of the crime scene, reimbursement for reasonable travel and living expenses if the trial is held somewhere other than where you live. You can get funds to be able to travel and stay there to be able to participate in the trial. And reimbursement of towing and storage if your vehicle was impounded due to the crime. The form can be located here. I do have it in the Dropbox as well for you. It looks like this, has the instructions there. And then if I can move this down so I can see. The application form is here. We have 2 minutes, so Nikki's not gonna be able to talk to you about that. I apologize, but she has done it and has information about it. And this is my confused, happy little horse, just because I needed a little something happy at the end of this. We have 2 minutes. We are happy to answer questions. Nikki, also please pop in if you have anything to add. I'm sorry we rushed through reparations so quickly.
Yeah. I'm gonna give people a moment to formulate their questions and just share, you know, we're happy for you to reach out to us after this webinar. We're happy to answer questions anytime, not just right now, and share with you the tips and tricks that we've learned through the years. Like we said, like Amy has at the bottom, don't ever hesitate to call us.
That's what we're here for. If no one ever called us, we'd just be sitting with phones doing nothing.
Well, I'm talking about our great ideas.
With each other.
Yeah.
That's true. We still like to talk to you all though, so call us.
Absolutely.
I don't see any raised hands or Q&A or anything in the chat. So I think maybe I'll just conclude here and you can contact Amy and Nikki later. Amy and Nikki, thank you so much for the presentation today. And now if there are no further questions, I will end the webinar.
Thanks for joining us, y'all. Have a great day.
Take care, all.